you very much. Thank you so much for having me. Good morning, and thank you so much to everyone at SKAGEN for the very warm welcome, all the organization, and it's a real pleasure to be here. My name is Louis-Vincent Gave, and as was said, I've been living in Hong Kong for the better part of the past 20 years. Before that, I lived in China a little bit, and before that, as my name implies, I was raised in France. And when I grew up in France, I went to a Jesuit school. And when I was at Jesuit school, we had a priest. He was very charismatic, very tall, very strong voice. And one day I turned to him and I said, "Father, is it true that Jesuit priests reply to every question with another question?" And he looked at me and he frowned his brow and he said, "Who told you that?" And this was, with the benefit of hindsight, this was good training for me for what was to come in China. As everyone at SKAGEN will tell you, investing is so much about asking the right questions. The problem is, of course, when you look at China, A, you're not quite sure what asking the right question is, and all too often, when you ask a question, you get 20 other questions in return. And with that in mind, what I'd like to do today with you, perhaps, is go through some of the questions I have about China, but I'd also like to ask you some questions. And I'll start off with a very simple one. The very simple question, you know, when you look at Chinese data, and you look at the incredible stability, for example, of Chinese GDP growth, I'll start off with a simple question for the audience and say, do you trust Chinese data? And can I get a show of hand of anyone who trusts Chinese data? All right, so that's about 0 for 300. That's pretty much par for the course. Yes, nobody trusts Chinese data. Nobody trusts Chinese data for very simple reasons. First, China is probably the one major economy to not have a free press. So it's sometimes hard to know really what's happening. This is why, as a firm, we have 10 people up in Beijing simply pretty much focused on trying to tell us what is happening. And this is why we also have a business doing nothing but corporate due diligence to try to find out really what is happening on the ground. It's not always an easy task. Like you, I don't trust Chinese data. Not only because China doesn't have a free press, but more importantly, China still has a ministry of propaganda. I mean, for all intents and purposes, that's what's written on the door. When you look at China, they have something called the publicity department of the Chinese Communist Party. And that's the name in China. Which brings me to my second question. What do you think this ministry of propaganda does all day? And it's not a mischievous question. Because let me ask you another question. When was the last time you read something positive about China? When was the last time you picked up the Wall Street Journal or the Financial Times or whatever, or Bloomberg or whatever you read, and you read something positive about China? Now, in a sense, this is surprising. This is a simple chart taken from The Economist, so arguably non-biased, which shows the contribution to global growth of the various major economies. And if you look really at the past decade, China has contributed roughly a third of global GDP growth, quarter in, quarter out. And China, last year, contributed more to global growth than the US, Japan, and Europe put together. And I'll come back to my other question. When was the last time you read something positive about China? Something that didn't tell you China was about to implode, China was massive social strife, pollution, etc., etc. What we've witnessed in China in the past 20 years, and is still going on, is in a sense the greatest economic miracle of the past 30 years. We've had 1 billion people come out of abject poverty. 30 years ago, people were starving. This is the biggest economic transformation in the history of humanity. But again, when was the last time you read something positive about China? Which begs the question, what do the guys at the Ministry of Propaganda do all day? I mean, honestly, you could say, well, you know, they work for the government, so maybe they're not very competent bureaucrats. That's one possibility, but I doubt it. The second possibility is that the situation is deteriorating so fast in China that even the spin doctors at the Ministry of Propaganda can't place a positive story on the international airwaves. That's possible, except the problem I have with that is that when you look at China from a bottom-up perspective, you don't see that kind of deterioration. You know, China's now the biggest market for iPhone. Last year, Levi Strauss sales in China were up 24%. You look at Alibaba sales, you look at China's now the biggest market for Boeing, for Airbus. From everywhere you care to look, it doesn't look as if China really is imploding. We can question, of course, the numbers, whether it's 6% growth or 4% growth or whatever, but the underlying demand has not imploded. So I don't personally think that the situation is so bad in China that the spin doctors can't put a positive spin on it. Which leaves you, again, with the possibility that the Ministry of Propaganda is a bunch of incompetents. Or I'd like to throw at you another possibility, and that's what I'd like to explore with you. That China has an inherent advantage, an inherent interest in perhaps painting a picture abroad of less strength than it really has. And why would that be? It would be for one of two reasons. The first is to hide China's reckless mercantilism in an age of, frankly, global deflation. The third and final possibility is to hide China's growing imperialism. But first, let's go to the first possibility, the one that you read about every day in the press on whether the Chinese economy is spinning out of control. Now, this is a chart highlighting growth in China's various regions, in China's 31 different provinces, growth in 2015. Black basically represents recession. Blue represents regions that are still in a massive boom. Now, as this chart highlights, what you saw in China last year and the year before is increasingly disparate growth between a Northeast where coal is produced, steel is produced, shipyards, chemicals, the deeply industrial part of the country, where that is today, frankly, in deep recession, and the rest of the country that is very much humming along. In a sense, China today, the Northeast of China, looks a lot like, say, the Northeast of Britain in the 1980s, or the Northeast of France in the 1980s. If you went to Leeds or to Newcastle in 1985, you probably wanted to slit your wrist. You would have thought there's no more depressing place in the world. If you go there today, you'd probably feel the same. But, and if you go to Northeast China, this is very much what we have today. We've had massive ramp up in the production capacity in things like steel, cement, etc., as China was building up its infrastructure. And now that a lot of this infrastructure is built, the need for all these industries is no longer there. Now imagine that you're Xi Jinping, you arrive in power 3 years ago, and this is the landscape that you have. Part of your country is booming, and part of your country is busting, almost for structural reasons. How do you deal with this? How do you deal with this disparate economy across regions? And again, I've got a bunch of charts to illustrate this, but perhaps the simplest chart to illustrate this is the one that you see on the top left here, which is tax receipts. For me, you know, in this time when you know there's so much skepticism around Chinese data, one of the hardcore data that we like to pin our hats on is tax receipts. Why? Because it represents real numbers. Regions have to report to the central government not only what their GDP growth was, but what their tax receipts were. And they can't really lie about the tax receipts because that's what the budgets are made out of. They can't say, oh, yeah, we raised 10 billion when they've only raised 7, because obviously then they'll have a 3 billion shortfall. Now, when you look at the tax receipts of the rest of China, what you find is that basically the tax receipts have been growing at 7 to 10% per year, really for the past 3 years. So the tax receipts in the rest of China tell you that growth is ballpark 7%. If you look at the North China, tax receipts are contracting. Tax receipts have been collapsing, which tells you that, of course, that part of China is in a deep recession. Which, once again, I said I'd have more questions than answers for you. If you were the Chinese government, and this is the economic landscape that you have, how do you deal with this disparity in growth? Now, Western investors look at this and say, well, China should devalue the renminbi and export its way back to prosperity. The problem with that, when you look at the China map, is that the exporting parts of China are the ones that are doing very well. Guangdong, the region around Shanghai, Zhejiang province, all the exporting region are booming along. The Northeast does not export very much. This is Chinese exports by province, and the value of their exports, both as a share of China's total exports and in US dollars. And the only two provinces of the North China Six that are in trouble are Shandong and Liaoning. And as you can tell, they're not hugely exporting provinces. So it's not obvious to me that you deal with structural overcapacity in steel, in coal, in cement, etc., through a currency devaluation. The second option is to do what Margaret Thatcher did. Come in and say, the coal mine doesn't work, the steel mill doesn't work, let's shut it down, and you guys get on your bikes and go find jobs where you can. Of course, this goes very much against what China's been trying to achieve for the past 40, 50 years, which is preventing 100 million people moving from the countryside in one go into towns like Shanghai and Guangdong, because the infrastructure challenges that this would represent would be absolutely daunting. Which brings you to the third possibility, which is, in essence, send good money after bad. Try to cushion the downturns in the northeast of China by subsidizing industries that, frankly, should be shut off. This, of course, is what my own country did, France, in the 1970s and 1980s. While England was shutting its coal mines and steel mills, France was taking a much slower approach to the project, which led to bigger increases in debt, etc. Now, I think one of the big regrets of most foreign investors is that 3 years ago when Xi Jinping came in, the talk was all about reform, was all about shutting down the inefficient producers. It was all about improving China's productive capacity. And fast forward 3-4 years later, and what you find is that instead of seeing that, we've seen more public investment in infrastructure. We've seen more companies and more SOEs kept afloat, and a lot less structural reduction in overcapacity that perhaps we were led to believe 3-4 years ago. I'll give you a couple numbers to contrast and compare. China already went through, in the late 90s, when I was first moved there, a massive reduction in structural overcapacity and a massive reform of SOE. Under Prime Minister Zhu Rongji, China fired 30 million, between the mid-90s and the late 90s, China fired 30 million state-owned enterprise workers, mostly in the Northeast. 30 million, that's a big number, even for China. That's more industrial workers than there are in the US today. The US has around 20 million manufacturing workers, so China fired 30 million manufacturing workers in the late 90s. That was proper structural reform. Right now, China is on a pace of firing around 1.5 million per year. So it's the pace of reform is nowhere near what we had in the late 90s. And I think the main reason for that is that Xi Jinping is still in a phase of consolidating his own power. When Zhu Rongji did that, he was in essence the Jiang Zemin Zhu Rongji team was in its second term. The way you can look at Xi Jinping is that he is still in his first term. And this year, we have the 19th Party Congress, which will tell us who the leaders that will follow Xi Jinping and Li Keqiang will be. And as you enter a party congress here, one of the things you know happens in China is that stability is tried to be kept at all cost. And so as you look to the coming year from now till October, one of the simplest bets you can have is that the Chinese government will do everything it can to not rock the boat over the coming 9 months. So in late December, in December, I went on a tour of the US and seeing all our US clients, and the bearishness on China was amazingly thick. The bearishness on China was deeply, deeply profound. And a lot of our clients were fearing that 2017 would see big collapse in the renminbi, implosion in the Chinese markets, etc. My point is very simple, is number one, the Chinese government still has a lot of policy tools at its disposal, as we saw in 2016, and I'll come to that in a minute. And it will use those tools to maintain social stability in a year of political transition. This year will not be a year with big developments in China. This year is a year where all of China's leaders get together in a room such as this one and basically spend 6 months planting knives into each other's backs and to figure out who's going to rise to the top. And unless you're in that room, don't expect any particular insights on future developments, which explains what we saw last year. If you think of the 2016 was obviously a year of a lot of surprises, and other speakers have talked about them, Trump, Brexit, etc. For us in Asia, one of the potential surprises was the extent to which Chinese growth not only held up, but frankly rebounded, triggering a rebound in commodities, triggering a rebound in Chinese real estate prices. And a lot of that, as these charts indicate, was very much driven by a strong rebound in government spending. If you look at the right-hand chart. Again, this goes back to the theme of stability at all cost. Or here's another way to look at the same thing. If you look at the slowdown in Chinese growth, this is GDP growth broken down by black is GDP growth, blue line is service industry growth, red line is industry and construction. What you really had in 2015 was a big slowdown in China, driven first and foremost by a slowdown in construction. And in 2016, again, one of the surprises of the year was the rebound in Chinese construction. Meanwhile, as you can tell, Chinese service industry growth remained very steady as she went, which meant that not only property sales hit a new all-time high, but property value hit a new all-time high, and floor area sold hit an all-time high. Now, with that picture, again, I come back to you. You got real estate making all-time highs. You got service industry growth being extremely stable. You got construction picking up. Is this to you the picture of an economy that is about to implode? And yet, this is all you read in the papers. All you read in the papers is an economy that is about to implode. A quick chart on Chinese property, because property is such a core driver of growth, and the ability of the Chinese government to stimulate and slow down Chinese property has historically been one of the key drivers of the changes in growth, as illustrated on that previous chart. How much longer can property remain a driver of growth? This is a simple chart looking at GDP per capita GDP compared to per capita living space. And if you look at China in 2008, China per capita living space was around 25 square meter per person. Today, we've evolved as China's housing stock has improved over the past decade. We're marginally above 30 square meters per person. In Europe, we're typically somewhere between 40 and 50 square meters. Now, this doesn't mean that China will be heading towards 40 and 50 square meters per person. But as incomes continue to grow, we have to acknowledge that the first demand of most people is to live in nicer places. Now, when you look at China, you still have about 200 million people that live in completely inadequate housing. Around 200 million people. So you still have underlying demand for improvement in housing stock, and China is still very far from reaching even the levels of, say, Portugal or Spain in terms of living space. Now, one of the big challenges, of course, is given this underlying constant underlying demand, housing in China is expensive, extremely expensive, in absolute terms and relative to incomes. And this reflects the fact, frankly, of a simple lack of space. When you look at the map of China, China has basically the same area as the United States. Except, of course, it has more than four times the population, and pretty much imagine a United States with four times the population and everyone living on the East Coast. Because, you know, the center of China is deserts, Tibetan plateau, all a bunch of areas that are fairly inhospitable to live in. And as a result, what you've seen in China is a big increase in debt and mortgages. And I've got a bunch of charts in the presentation, and I'm sure if you want this presentation, SKAGEN, I'm sure we'll send it to you. So the second big story of China, along with growth, has been a story of increasing debt. And this is especially so since the 2008 crisis. In 2008, China roughly had total debt to GDP, if you include everything, local governments, businesses, individuals, central government, had a total debt of roughly 150% of GDP. Today, you add it all, you're roughly at 250% debt to GDP. And that right here is the source of most people's concerns. But let's put it in perspective. You add up all the debt in the US, you're at 370% of GDP. You add up all the debt in France, where I'm from, you're roughly at 350% debt to GDP. Now, in France, if we grow by 1%, we'll pop the champagne. We'll be really proud of ourselves. In China, let's be bearish. Let's say China grows by 4%. Let's say 3%. China still potentially has the ability to grow out of its debt. In the Western world, in my view, very few countries do. So the question remains, does this debt increase mean that China face a crisis? Well, frankly, when you look at China relative to most other countries out there, and this is China's household debt, which indeed has increased a lot, mostly to finance real estate, you might get worried because it is on a fast acceleration pace, but you're still below pretty much any major country out there. Even you're below debt in countries such as Thailand, Korea and other emerging markets. And this brings me to a simple point. For all the talk about how China potentially faces a financial crisis, if we look at the past 50 years and the history of financial crises, and before me was one of the greatest historians of financial crises, so I'm a little humbled to be speaking about this, but in my mind, there's two ways countries basically go bust. The first, you have a country that runs large current account deficits for years, and in essence becomes dependent on the willingness and kindness of strangers to fund their debt. And one day foreigners wake up and say, you know what? I don't want to buy any more Argentina bonds. I don't want to buy any more Greek bonds. I don't want to buy any more Spanish bonds. I already have too many. And that day, the country needs to have a big devaluation and a big debt restructuring, or the country implodes. The economy implodes. Now, this kind of crisis that you see on the left is not going to happen in China. The reality is that the increase in Chinese debt has absolutely not been funded by foreigners. Let me ask you this. How many of you in this room own Chinese debt? Foreigners have not funded Chinese growth. The increase in Chinese debt has been wholly funded by Chinese savings, not by foreign savings. So this kind of crisis isn't going to happen. The second kind of crisis that you often see is you get a real estate bull market, and banks love lending to real estate because, you know, it's easy for them. There's an asset, they know how to do it. And so banks start lending aggressively to real estate. And then one day, banks outgrow their capacity to lend given their own deposits. And so they start borrowing money on money markets, start borrowing money on bond markets. They borrow short to lend long. And here lies perdition. Each time banks borrow short to lend long, you have to start getting worried. And the question is, could this be happening in China? Could this be what we are now facing? And I'll skip a few charts in the interest of time. But the reality is, it most likely will happen one day, but we're still very, very far from it. Because when you look at Chinese banks, the way you have to conceptualize Chinese banks is that these are poorly managed banks that make bad loans. And NPLs tend to be fairly high. But at the same time, they're extremely conservatively run institutions. If you look at total credit in China is equal to 1x bank deposit, which means that Chinese banks do not fund themselves on money markets. They do not fund themselves on bond markets. Chinese banks fund themselves on the fact that China in the past 20 years has gone from 200 million bank depositors to 800 million bank depositors. This is the big transformation. The increase in debt in China has been made possible by the fact that all of a sudden, in the past 10, 15 years, the savings have come out of the mattress and gone into the banking system. And for a bank, there is no more stable way to fund itself than through the deposits of the broader public. My father always says that people are more likely to change wives than to change banks. And and this is true. This is true. The bank deposits are immensely, immensely safe, which means that, which is why when you talk to the big China bears, inherently, the bearish scenario on China is always very simple. And it has to come down to this. It's that the general public will take their money out of the banks and put their money abroad. That's the only way you can get to a bearish scenario in China. Which brings you to the big question of the day and the question of capital outflows in China. And this chart right here. The Chinese central bank reserves, which have gone from the $4 trillion down to $3 trillion in the past couple of years. And here, I come back to my first question to you. Do you trust Chinese data? Because this piece of data, you get from the Chinese central bank. So if you're not gonna trust Chinese GDP, and you're not gonna trust Chinese industrial production, and you're not gonna trust Chinese retail sales, or bank deposits, or whatever else, why are you gonna trust this one? The reason I ask this is fairly simple. Is last year, this time last year, we were told $1 trillion left China in the past 6-12 months. And I looked at that and I thought, gee, how did it leave and where did it go? Because $1 trillion is a whole lot of money. At the same time, I know this. I know that last year, China ran a $600 billion trade surplus. Which means that for reserves to shrink by $1 trillion, basically you would have needed $1.5 trillion of capital outflows. And again, that's a whole lot of money to move around. How did it leave and where did it go? Now, a lot of it went to repay US dollar debt. Chinese corporates in the past year have repaid probably around $300 billion of US dollar debt. And you see that in the books of HSBC, in the books of Standard Chartered, in the books of all the big banks that do business in China. But that, in essence, is a fairly positive development. There is a lot less US dollar debt in China today than there is elsewhere. But you're still left with the question of, how did so much money make it out? There's a few ways for people to take money out in China. One of them is through the Hong Kong Shanghai Connect. You can open a brokerage account in Shanghai and buy Hong Kong shares, hereby pushing money out of China. But the volumes on the Hong Kong Shanghai Connect have been dismal. And now they've opened the Shenzhen Connect, and what you find is on any given day, only a quarter to a third of the daily allocation is being used. So for all the talk about how people are lining up to take their money out, the legal ways that people have to do it, you don't really see that big increase in cash coming out. If you look at Macau, which has historically been one of the key ways for the Chinese general public to get money out of China, gambling revenues have collapsed by two-thirds. Now, I also come to a simple point, is if China pushed $1.5 trillion out, where did it go? Then you know there's a few asset classes that the Chinese like to buy. Chinese like to buy in Vancouver, like to buy in Sydney, like to buy in Melbourne. And what you find in these markets is that while prices have continued to go up, mostly on the back of Chinese money, the volume on transactions has absolutely collapsed. The volume of transactions. So last year, you had about $20 billion of Chinese money that went into Canadian real estate. $20 billion. That's a lot of money, enough to impact prices in Toronto and Vancouver. But in the whole scheme of things, it's not a sign of enormous, enormous capital outflow. And to me, I come to the conclusion that I come back to this chart. This chart to me is the most troubling. In a world that is highly, highly deflationary, China has been running trade surpluses that are not only the biggest trade surpluses in China's history, they're the biggest trade surpluses in human history. And what do? We have a G20 meeting in Shanghai, and we slap China on the back and we say, well done for not devaluing. Bravo you. Are you kidding? In a world with very little growth, China is sucking $600 billion worth of growth from the rest of the world, and we congratulate them for not devaluing? Maybe the Ministry of Propaganda is not as incompetent as everybody would assume. Here's another chart for you. This is the growth in exports. How many times have you heard that China is losing competitiveness to Indonesia, to South Korea, and to others? Right here is a chart pretty much illustrating that this isn't the case. Chinese export growth has remained buoyant. How come China gets no grief for charts such as this one, highlighting China's steel exports, basically killing the steel exports of everybody else? Now, I'm running out of time, but I'll take 2 minutes to highlight what worries me the most, actually. And that is that beyond hiding China's mercantilism, the Ministry of Propaganda could also be hiding China's deep imperialism. And what do I mean by that? What do we know about Xi Jinping? Xi Jinping is the most nationalist president that China's had since Mao Zedong. And whenever Xi Jinping talks, he talks about two things. He talks about the anti-corruption drive, which is about controlling the excesses of the Communist Party, and he talks about the China dream. And the China dream is really code word for building a Chinese empire. Now, the history of every empire is a history of fundamentally a road-building exercise. This is why in Europe we say all roads lead to Rome. Empires want to bring in commodities cheaper and push out goods, finished goods, to the outer realms of the empire. And what does Xi Jinping talk about all day? He talks about One Belt, One Road, Silk Road Fund, Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. For Xi Jinping, in the 21st century, all roads lead to Beijing, not all roads lead to Rome. And just like every empire before it, the British Empire built the Suez Canal, the American Empire built the Panama Canal, China's building a canal in Thailand to link the South China Sea and the Indian Ocean and hereby bypass the Malacca Straits that remain controlled by the US fleet. Now, if your aim is to be an empire, do you A, go around and say, we're here, we're big, we're strong, time for the US to leave Asia? Option one. Or do you do it on the sly? This is a simple chart that was shown to me by a Beijing academic. And it shows British and German GDP in the 19th century. And what was the year that German GDP moved above British GDP? It was 1914. And at the time, Kaiser Wilhelm's thumping his chest and saying, we're Germany, we're big, we're strong, and China and France, Britain needs to make room for us. We need colonies in Africa. We need colonies in Asia. And France and Britain decide, actually, we don't need to make room for you. And of course, that was one of the worst failures of public policy in Europe in the history of public policy failures. Today, if you're China, and as your GDP starts to move above that of the US, do you go around saying, we're here, we're big, we're strong, the US needs to leave? Or do you bid your time and continue moving your pieces on the board, picking out countries one by one, picking out the Philippines, shifting them from a US alliance to a Chinese alliance, picking out Malaysia, shifting it from a US alliance to picking out Indonesia, picking out Saudi Arabia, moving contracts from US dollar and into renminbi. Now, of course, and this brings me to my investment conclusion, if you want to be an empire, you cannot be an empire on somebody else's dime. You cannot be an empire without a strong currency. And which brings me to today's fears about the renminbi and why I do not share them. Doesn't mean the renminbi can't go down on a given year. But if China wants to have a long-term ambition of being an empire, it has no choice but to have a structurally strong currency. If China wants the renminbi, and it does want the renminbi, to be Asia's Deutschmark, to be Asia's trading and reserve currency, for why else would it open up its bond market? Why else would it liberalize its currency if that wasn't the end goal? Then China needs to deliver on its bond market broadly the same returns as US treasuries. And lo and behold, this is what it's done. If you've invested $100 in Chinese government bonds, you will have returned over the past 5 years, you will have returned the red line. In US treasuries, you will return the blue line, and in German bonds, because of the devaluation in the euro, you would have gotten crushed. Now, this means, for me, that Chinese government bonds remain a very attractive risk-reward trade, especially relative to US treasuries. And here's a simple chart, and I'll conclude with that and open up for question. Today, everybody is worried that the Chinese will sell their renminbi. Instead, ask yourself this. What if foreigners need to start using renminbi? What if tomorrow China becomes 10% of the world MSCI and 10% of the global bond index? Who will then be the natural seller of renminbi? Because remember, China runs a trade surplus of $500 or $600 billion. When tomorrow everyone in this room, when I ask in this room who owns Chinese debt and everyone in this room raises their hand, who will have sold the renminbi to them for that to happen? And with that in mind, I'd love to take any questions that you perhaps have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Louis-Vincent. Very, very interesting to hear your take there on China. Remind you, there are the question cards. If anyone has anything on this hugely important topic, then do raise your hands. I got a few to start with, and the first one, you already alluded and touched on this, but the question is, China's FX reserves plunged and are just over $3 trillion. Are the reserves adequate to defend the currency for the next 1 to 2 years, or would they let the currency depreciate further?
I personally, well, I think, yes, very much they're adequate. $3 trillion is still a lot of money. More importantly, I think what's happened in the past, really, 2-3 years, is China has diverted. It hasn't been as much capital flight as the big fear is, but it's been very much government policy to move money away from US treasuries, where, after all, returns have been very low. And let's face it, they've moved away from US treasuries pretty much at the high of the bond market, and try to seek returns elsewhere. I think if China really was afraid of capital flight, they wouldn't let Chinese state-owned enterprise do things like buy Sygenta for 45 billion Swiss franc. They wouldn't be funding things like the Silk Road Fund and the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. They wouldn't be funding this Thai Canal. I lived through the Asian crisis, and at the time of the Asian crisis, reserves were clearly inadequate, and all the Asian currencies collapsed. And at the time, you didn't have every big company in across Asia go around and basically buy companies abroad, which is, of course, what you are seeing in China today. So on this note, you know, for me, this is the probable paths of China going forward. Today, the big fear of the market is this, that we have a financial crisis on the back of massive capital flight. I think this is an extremely low odds scenario. What's much more likely is either China continues to increase debt, continues to refuse to take out the excess capacity and basically slowly transforms itself into Japan. And by the way, if this occurs, this is not a bearish scenario for the currency. Remember that between 1990 and 2002, the yen went from 150 to 75 to the US dollar. Deflation is fundamentally good for currencies. Inflation is fundamentally bad. Deflation is fundamentally good. Which is why, by the way, through Japan's deflationary bust, all the JGB holders, all the JGB shorters got absolutely killed. And today, it's the same guys who shorted JGBs massively who are telling you to short the renminbi. Another option, of course, is that Chinese growth ends up decent. So for me, the range of outcomes is somewhere in between. And when the market starts to get too bearish, you want to move back towards Chinese stocks. When the market gets a little over carried away, you move back towards equities.
You mentioned state-owned enterprises. And for us as investors, it's interesting to see, you know, how important the profit motive may or may not be. And you see in many industries, it's more important to gain share or perhaps to keep people employed and so on. So I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. Are you seeing any shifts there in the mentality from the top? And what do you think would take in order to move in that direction?
That's the big challenge. And I think that's why, in spite of terrific top-line growth, returns on Chinese equities have been fairly uninteresting, highly volatile and broadly uninteresting. The answer to your question, I think, is on a macro level, China all too often is like Japan. You know, we want to keep employment, we want to keep social stability, we'll send good money after bad, we'll keep SOEs alive. And so on a top-down level, that's problematic. And it's especially the case in specific industries, all the heavy industry, steel, coal, etc. Partly because of the regional concentration. It's very hard for the government to say, okay, let's pull the plug on this because it would mean the collapse of entire regions. Now, on a bottom-up level, you definitely find some great companies that are profit-incentivized and that are growing very well. In general rule, what you want to be involved in China is sectors and businesses where you do not really compete with SOEs, where you do not really compete with the government, and there you stand an opportunity to really make money. Mm-hmm. Now, interestingly, in most of the Western world, healthcare, when you're in healthcare, you're having to deal and compete with the government. In China, a lot less. So while you don't want to touch steel and coal, et cetera, healthcare on the flip side can be quite interesting.
Right. There's another question, more on the political side, and that is, what do you think will be the U.S. reaction to China's growing imperialism, and how might they prevent it?
That's a very tough one, because the uncertainty around the U.S. is obviously quite high. What it seems to me is that the U.S. population in general is tired of being an empire, and they don't want to carry the costs of being an empire. Barack Obama was the first sign of a U.S. that was retrenching onto its own borders. You know, Barack Obama launched what he called the pivot to Asia. And, you know, and then he said, look, we're going to focus a lot more on Asia, et cetera. And what was the end result? Basically, the U.S. lost the Philippines, its longest dating ally, and pretty much lost Malaysia as well, which is important because that controls the Malacca Straits. That was under Obama. It seems to me that under Trump, what we're seeing is further isolationism of the U.S., further retreat onto its own borders. And under Trump, what we have is probably a U.S. government that tells its military, look, we want you to do less with less. I think we'll see, a rollout in, basically a roll down in China, in the U.S.'s military commitment around the world. The response for that, if you're Taiwan, if you're Korea, if you're Japan, has to be that you got to increase your defense spending massively.
There's another question here, an interesting one, which is, what about the Chinese ability to innovate? Will they be able to create tomorrow's global champions in terms of multinational enterprises?
That's perhaps the most important question. I'll be honest, the answer is, I don't know. So far what China's done, when you look at the growth, China in a sense you could say is already there. China has the second biggest internet sector in the world. You know, you look at Alibaba, you look at Baidu, you look at Ctrip, all these businesses. You know, what other stock market has an internet sector worth more than $1 trillion in market cap aside from the US? Just China. But so far what China's mostly done is taken US technologies, things that work in the US or in the Western world, and said, well, we'll take it and we'll adapt it a little bit to the Chinese market, and boom, here it goes. And there's still a lot of growth in doing that. For China, for the next 10 years, there's still a lot of growth in just copying the West. So if you're a smart entrepreneur, why would you try to reinvent the wheel? Why would you try to do something challenging when you can just basically copy what they do in the West, modify it for the domestic market, and still make lots of money? And so far, that's all we've seen. We haven't seen genuine, true innovation. To get to the next phase of growth, China right now is still playing catch-up growth, catch-up with the West, taking the techniques from the West, and that carries you another 10 years. To go beyond that, indeed, you need to go to innovation. The way we put it in our firm is there's two kinds of growth. You've got Ricardian growth, which is about rearranging more optimally the factors of production, which is what China's still doing, and then you've got Schumpeterian growth, which is new inventions, new creations, which... And the reason I said I don't know is that you need several things for that to happen. The first, you need obviously a very strong educational system. Now, China actually has that. And that is perhaps the single most important development in China. When I lived in China in the early 90s and went to university there, China was graduating 300,000 university students a year. Last year, China graduated 7 million university students. So, you know, that's an improvement in human capital, such as the world has never seen in such a short period of time. So that's very optimistic for creation. But you also need a rule of law, I think, and you need protection of intellectual property. And China definitely doesn't have that. And the question is, in the next 10 years, can China put in place the legal infrastructure to have that? And they are working on it, but there's no guarantee that they'll get there. So the answer is, I don't know. I'm sorry.
Right. One last very quick question, or a quick reply at least, we're a little bit behind the schedule, and that is, if Trump introduces 20% duty on imports into the US, what would be the likely reply from China?
Again, a tough one. I think China will have to reply, if only for face-saving measures. So there'll be, they'll slap some tariffs on Apple and on General Motors, and they'll make it more complicated for U.S. businesses to do business in China. Whether it ends up being more than just a face-saving thing, we'll have to see. Today, I think that is undeniably the big uncertainty of the world that we live in. In that, you know, for the past 30 years, China has been one of the biggest beneficiaries of globalization. China has become, you know, the manufacturing center for the world. And in the Western world, the move is clearly on a big pushback against globalization. And the question we're all confronting as investors is, are we reaching today the end of globalization? And if we are, what shape does that take? Now, China is actually, I think, strong enough and has enough domestic demand today, and I have a bunch of charts there on domestic demand that I didn't have a chance to go through, but again, SKAGEN can send them to you. China has enough domestic demand that the economy won't collapse. But it is a big, dark source of uncertainty.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Louis-Vincent, again.
Thank
you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.